Brother Gazette, please join me in the call to worship. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome.
Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shined.
We have beheld Christ's glory, glory and acceptance of the Son from the Father.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given.
In him was life.
Please join me in prayer. Loving God, help us remember the birth of Jesus, that we may share in the song of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and worship of the wise men. Close the door of hate and open the door of love all over the world. Deliver us from evil by the blessings which Christ brings, and teach us to be full of the joy you bring, with clear and open hearts. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join us for another song. Please stand.
Amen.
of our Lord be with you all. And now you may please share the peace. We went in and
cleaned out. We found rat feces and bugs and a dead animal in the bedroom where his grandmother and her two children slept. They were dear. They were as nice a family as you can imagine. They loved each other. They were excited that we were there, but I could not pull it together. And as the day went on, we started work. We ripped out all the flooring. The grandmother, the two firstborns who were there, offered all of us food, and nobody wanted to accept her offer. They're polite about it, but it was so dirty. Well, that afternoon, Rob was talking to the boys, and I heard him tell them that no matter what she offered, they really should accept it. Something, a glass of water. He didn't want what she was offering, except a glass of water. But she was like the woman in the Bible who was offering what she had. The 2 pence, the 2 coins. It was everything she had that she was offering us. It was like he hit me with a 2x4. And the next morning, she offered me the 3rd cup of coffee. And so I accepted the cup of coffee, and I went and sat down with her. And it was the biggest gift that anyone's ever given me. We talked, and we shared about our families and what our hopes were for our families. We prayed together. I still pray for her. ASP is not just about what we do for others. It's what we can learn about our own hearts and about our own lives. You don't have to travel to Guatemala. Although if you do, it's amazing. But we have people in our own backyard who need our love and who need our support and who need our assistance. If you haven't been on ASP and you would like to go, we would love to have you. We have a trip planned for June 16th through the 22nd. We have spaces for 40 people. A lot of those are already full. I do still need some adult leaders. If you're interested in going or you're able to go, it is an amazing trip. It is so much fun. I know I've told kind of a heavier story about it, but we have a great time. I'm not going to be able to go on the trip this year, so we need some women to go. So if you feel called or you think you know someone who might be interested in going, I would be glad to talk to you more about it. And if there's any questions, I'll be glad to answer those as well. So thank you.
Thank you, Beth. If that does not mean you want to sign up and go or donate or help, I mean, this is just a fantastic trip. The kids are excited. Great parents, so thank you for that. Get ready for our offering. This is how the earth praises God, giving thanks for God's abundance. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks, and the valleys deck themselves with shimmering fields of grain, sharing their bounty with the rest of creation. We, too, are to worship God by being abundant and fruitful with our lives, offering up our yields as if they were songs of joyful praise. Let us worship God with our gifts.
Thank you.
widely. As we dedicate this offering, we offer ourselves too, for these gifts of money are but tokens of ourselves. Take and use us, that our hands may reach out in service, our feet may walk the difficult path of reconciliation, and that our words may be words of peace. For this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now Chip has some fantastic announcements for us.
You know about yourself. Well, good morning, everybody. A few, mostly sort of calendar updates here. A few things I want to make sure you are aware of. The first is coming up this Wednesday, our first annual HBC panel show, so you don't want to miss that. So you come for our regular meal, and then you get to see a great show as well. So that's this Wednesday. Other things to be aware of, March 30th, which is a Saturday, just a couple weeks away, is our annual yard sale. And so if you are interested in giving, donating goods to it, or helping to organize or do any of those things, we need all of that. All the details about when donations can be picked up, when they can be dropped off, all those things are in the announcement handout that is in the back if you can grab one. So you can see, any of us if you have any questions about that. That's on the 30th. The very next day, March 31st, is our Youth Sunday, so you want to make sure that you're here for that. That's it's a unified service day, so we'll have one service at 10 o'clock here in the Fellowship Hall, followed by Sunday School at 11, and you don't want to miss that. Youth Sunday is always a really special day. Then April 12th, from 5:30 to 7:30, that's a Friday night, we're having our HBC Egg Extravaganza, which is a night of family and kid-friendly. Yes, it will be excellent. That's right.
I'm really excited.
And that's enough. it's really going to be a fun night for our community, but we've also designed it to be kind of sort of the perfect opportunity to invite a friend or a family member or coworker that you know of that doesn't have a church home right now. It's a fun night, low bar entries. Fun and games and fellowship. But then that Sunday is Palm Sunday, and we had a couple of weeks, so it's a great time to get them some new people connected here at Highland. Then the final announcement, I want to let everybody know that this week we signed the contract for the roof repair, which is for a sanctuary, which is very exciting. And all of the other hurricane related repairs are either completed or in process. Sun Valley is in process, some of the session rooms and the other things are in process. A lot of work has already been done, and that will continue. The roof will not be finished by then, but we will be in the sanctuary for Easter. So that's pretty exciting. I think those are all of the announcements. Jen, am I missing anything? No? All right, well then I would invite all the kids to come up for the children's message.
You can't hide behind the sheriff there, I see you. Oh, here they all come. Good morning, friends. How are you? How many candies did you have table this morning? Zero. Anyway, I don't believe you. I'm very proud. So, well, happy St. Patrick's Day. How are you? But you could give them a card. You could write them a letter. You could do all of those kinds of things, okay? So think about other things in life. When someone does something that hurts you, you could forgive them.
Say sorry.
You could say that you're sorry, right? You could pray for your friends. So instead of just worrying about saving up a whole bunch of money and buying things, it's nice to save up and do nice things for people so you guys can work on having treasures in heaven instead of just treasures on earth. So God wants you guys to store lots of things and do nice things for others. So what are you going to share? Nothing? You're in a prayer today. I can tell. So as we finish this St. Patrick's Day, you think about the gold and the silver and all those things, and make sure we also are saving up our treasures in heaven. So before we leave this morning, before you can collect your necklace, let us have a little prayer. Can you hold your hands? And here we go. Father, we may never have much in the way of earthly treasures, but help us to be faithful and kind each day and build up our treasures in heaven. Amen.
When no one had seen the boy, Mary and Joseph rushed back to Jerusalem and searched for him. After 3 days of separation, they finally found him, sitting among a group of religious teachers in the temple, asking them questions, listening to their answers. Everyone was surprised and impressed that a 12-year-old boy could have such deep understanding and could answer questions with such wisdom. His parents, of course, had a different reaction. Mary said to him, "Son, why have you treated us this way? Listen, your father and I have been sick with worry for the last 3 days, wondering where you were, looking everywhere for you." Jesus responded, "Why did you need to look for me? Didn't you know that I must be working for my father?" Neither Mary nor Joseph really understood what he meant by this. Jesus went back to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. His mother continued to store these memories like treasures in her heart. And Jesus kept on growing in wisdom, in physical stature, in favor with God, and in favor with others. This is the word of the Lord. We pray to you. God, thank you for all you do and all you have done for us. Help us feel renewed wonder and joy in the gift of your Son, Jesus. Guide us to share the joy of Christ's coming in the way we live our lives. Help us to spread this good news of great joy with all those around us. Amen. Well, here we are, week 22 of the story, and if I'm going with full disclosure here, this is the first time, I think, in all of those weeks that on Monday morning, I wasn't already sure what I was going to talk about this morning. Chapter 22 of the story, if you're following along, if you're reading along with us, it's all about Jesus' birth and his first few years here on earth. And I don't want anybody to misunderstand, of course, this is a great story, right? It's a great story filled with the miraculous, right? Mary is pregnant with Jesus, even though she's a virgin, and there are wonderful examples of faithfulness and trust in God, both from Mary and from Joseph and even from a few others. But this story is also probably the most well-known story in the history of the world, right? I mean, this is a story we all know, and for most of the last 21 weeks, I have struggled with how to fit all of the things that maybe weren't so familiar into this, 18-minute sermon box, right? How do I tell you about all these really wonderful, interesting things that are happening that we maybe don't already know about? How many of us really knew the story of Esther, really knew some of the other stuff, Nehemiah, and rebuilding the wall, as all of that? So I spent some time this week struggling to figure out how to say something new about this great story that we all know so well. But then at one point it hit me that even though many of us know this story so well, the reality of our world is that no matter how familiar we are with it, not everybody knows this story. Not everybody knows this story. The details of the story are so clear to us, we can likely, just list them off, right? There are angel visitations and a virgin birth. There's no room at the inn. There's shepherd's visits and visits from wise men. But lots of the people that you see and know in your daily life, and let's not make any assumptions, maybe some of the people in this room don't really know this story. And that fact is both a challenge and an opportunity for us. The challenge is that we must begin to see this familiar story with new eyes, through a new lens. And we have to do that so that we can reclaim the wonder and the excitement that we had when we first heard and understood this story of Christ coming to be with us. You know, when you see something new or exciting or really just amazing, right? I don't know if any of you saw a couple weeks ago there was this viral video about you can pull apart pieces of a pineapple, right? And anybody see this? Okay, well, you can see where it is. thank you, Rick. But I mean, it was been great to cut off the bottom, and then they just pulled, you know, it's like working the little pieces, they were just pulling it off. And this was amazing to me. I probably talked about it to 15 people. That was 2 weeks ago. Now I'm like, now the pineapples I bought last week to try this are still sitting on the counter, untouched. You know, it's not that exciting anymore. After you've seen something a few times, after you've thought about it for a while, it kind of loses some of the sheen, right? Some of the excitement. And if we want people to know Jesus, if we want people to know this story, we need to be excited like we just saw it for the first time. We have to still be filled with wonder and awe. And this is critical because no matter how familiar we are with the particulars of this story, it is still remarkable. It should still fill us with wonder and awe. The Message translation of John 1:14 is maybe one of my favorite passages in all of Scripture, and it renders that verse this way. The Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. Love that. And God, that should fill us with wonder and awe. God became flesh and blood and moved into our neighborhood. God became one of us, came near to us on purpose because he loves us. This is wonderful and amazing good news. It is maybe the best news, and it should still excite us even if we've heard the story before. Friday and Saturday this week I flew up to Pittsburgh for a mission conference board meeting, and I was sitting there waiting to get on the plane. And you know, if you've flown a lot of times, you can kind of take it for granted. But I had, for some reason, I just had this moment where I thought, you know, it's pretty crazy and amazing. Maybe the news of the week, you know, the grounding of some planes was on my mind. But I just kept thinking, you know, it's kind of amazing that this metal tube that weighs thousands of pounds is going to go up in the air and then come down safely. Like, that's amazing. And like I said, you know, if you've flown enough times, you don't even think about that anymore. It's just something standard you do. But if you stop and think about it, you know, it's no less amazing every time it happens, right? It's still, you know, something that weighs thousands and thousands of pounds going up into the air, staying there, and still wants to come down. That's crazy. And when we encounter, when we share the story of Christ's coming, we need to do just like what I did in the airport on Friday. We need to stop and slow down and really listen and think about the story for a minute. Even the familiar parts, even the parts we just don't even really think about. We need to stop and think about not just the what's in the story, all the players that we can all name, but the whys and the hows. Why did Jesus come? How and why did Mary put their trust in God's plan even when they didn't know all the details of that plan? Because I think if we are regularly mining this story for new insights and wisdom, I believe that the Holy Spirit will show them to us. And the joy and the wonder that comes from these new discoveries, even in a familiar story, will help us to share this good news with others as it deepens our own faith. And you know, like we talked about in the beginning, many of us know all the details of this story. The young, unwed mother, birth in a humble manger, etc., etc. But in thinking about those details this week, something kind of clicked for me. And you know, we have been talking a lot lately here in worship about living into the lives that God has called us to, and about using all that God has given us to the fullest. And when I think about what that means, if I'm honest, it can be a little bit overwhelming. I really, truly believe that God has big plans for us, and God has big plans for Highland. But I don't know exactly how to get there. And sometimes I feel like I don't really details of this story bear witness to some important truths we need to think about as we try to live into the call of God in our own lives. And the first of them is this: Mary and Joseph didn't know how things were going to turn out. And we miss that sometimes with really familiar stories. You forget, like, we didn't know the first time as it was happening, we didn't know how it was going to turn out. Mary and Joseph didn't know how things were going to turn out. In fact, and the story from Luke gives us a little context, right? They didn't even know what was going to happen next. You think Jesus perfect, right? He was probably a pretty obedient child. He stayed back in Jerusalem. His parents were a day away, right? I would have been in trouble. Our kids would be in trouble. They didn't know what was coming next with Jesus. But yet, through it all, they trusted in God. And they trusted that there was a reason and a plan why God had called them to be part of his story. Jesus' birth, his coming into the world, becoming flesh and blood and living amongst us, is the linchpin of history, which the rest of the story of the world revolves around. It's the single most important moment in the history of the universe, and don't miss this in your familiarity with the story. The single most important night in the history of the universe, and the night it happened, it didn't even make the local news. Right? The night it happened, nobody knew. I feel like I've been hearing about the royal baby for years. I don't know how that's possible, right? I don't follow this stuff, and I know more about the royal family and their kids, their soon-to-be kids, than I care to know. But on the night that Jesus was born, there was no paparazzi coverage. There were no crowds or cameramen waiting to get a glimpse of the Christ child. In fact, other than Mary and Joseph, the only people that took any notice at all were a small group of shepherds. Right? And shepherds, not exactly high society folks. And so the point I want us to get in the context of the story is this: even literally, the biggest thing in the history of the world started small. The moment the biggest thing in the history of the world happened, the moment it got started, nobody noticed. Barely anyone at all noticed when the world was forever changed. So I don't think we should get discouraged if we feel God calling us to something big, and we take that step of faith out to try and do it, and the world doesn't notice immediately. Things don't change in an instant. I think we need to have faith and trust, remembering that even Jesus didn't get noticed at first. And likewise, I think we shouldn't get discouraged or confused if we feel like what God has put in front of us right now appears to not matter. I mean, think about it. How in the world could an unwed, pregnant teenager in an occupied territory 2,000 years ago matter? How in the world could that be important to anyone other than her family? That's the most important moment in history. So we need to remember that God often takes little things and overlooks people and does big, wonderful, and miraculous things with them when they are faithful. And it all begins, as it did with Mary and Joseph, with trusting in God and moving forward into God's call in faith right now. You can't wait for the stars to be aligned. You can't wait for the world to be watching. If God has called you, step forward in faith now. If God has called you, now is the time. Don't wait. And then, we know the story. Many of us are very familiar with it. We know the shepherds weren't the only ones to come and see the baby. And although it was likely quite some time after Jesus was born, certainly wasn't the night of his birth, Jesus and Mary and Joseph did have another set of well-known visitors that brought him gifts fit for a king. And the juxtaposition, the comparison of these two very different sets of visitors that the baby Jesus had, the shepherds, the magi, the wise men, remind us of an important truth about this good news. It is for all of us. The good news of Christ's coming is for all of us. The story has the humblest beginnings imaginable, and the very first people, the shepherds, to hear the good news, they were the dregs of society, right? Often shepherds, even when they weren't watching their sheep, were forced to sleep and live outside the main city because they smelled like sheep so bad, right? And these were not, respected people. They were not in society. They were not well thought of. But this next group that comes to see Jesus, this next group that seems to have at least some awareness of what is happening, the birth of Jesus, the Magi, or the wise men, whatever we call them, they're the exact opposite of the shepherds. They were educated, right? The reason they know about Jesus is they discovered the star that announced Jesus coming. They were respected, right? Remember, when they came in, they gained an audience, even though he didn't know them, they had gotten an audience with King Herod. Right? So these people were important people. And they were wealthy, right? They could afford to take 6 months off to go searching after why a star was found in the sky. They could go on a long journey. They could bring expensive gifts fit for a king to Jesus. God came and moved into not just that neighborhood, not just your neighborhood or my neighborhood. God came and drew near to all of us. God in Jesus Christ came for each and every one of us and brought the good news of salvation for each of us. Whether we are more like the shepherds, or more like the wise men, or likely somewhere in between, God came for you. God came for you, and for me, and for all of us. And this is indeed good news. But remember as well that the next person that found out about this turning point in history that is the birth of Jesus Christ, Herod, and Herod found out from the wise men about Jesus' birth. He didn't have the same perspective as the Magi and as the shepherds. And Herod doesn't receive Christ's coming as good news, but importantly, he doesn't receive this good news not because he doesn't understand what it means. I don't think he fully understood what Christ's coming meant, but rather he did have some understanding of what it meant, and that's why it scared him. That's why he didn't hear it as good news in his life. Christ's coming at the birth of the Messiah meant that Herod was no longer in charge when the one that is born, and before he's even born, his name is King of Kings. Right? If you're the king, his birth is in good news. Right? But understand, we have something in common with Herod. Because that meaning that Herod took so hard that he understood that Christ's coming meant he wasn't in charge anymore. Christ's coming means that for us as well. Christ coming into our lives, in order for it to be good news for us, means that we aren't in charge anymore. Our Father, our Creator, the God of the universe, needs to be in charge. And although it's scary and we want to hold on to control, this is wonderful news too. Because simply put, we aren't designed to be in charge. We aren't equipped or capable of being in charge. We don't have the tools, the discipline, or the wisdom to run our lives the way they should be run, to make us who we were created to be. The good news of the gospel only becomes good news for you or for me if we're willing to let go of the control and give ourselves and our very lives over to God. We can't hold on to all of our control and still say thanks for coming. The one who promises to be with us, to guard us, to shelter us, the one who loves us so very much that he sent his only son to live and to die for us. That's the one who needs to be in charge. That's the one that we need to trust. That's who we need to listen to. And so my prayer for each of us this week is that we might recognize the gift of giving God control. We might be overwhelmed with just how good this news is, that it isn't all on our shoulders, but we can literally give it to God, that we might be reminded of just how good and wonderful this news is, and reminded of the good news, filled with awe and wonder about what it means that the Lord of the universe became flesh and blood and moved into our neighborhood on purpose because of you. That might fill us with awe and wonder and joy, and we might then go forth from this place, filled with wonder, to share the good news. Amen. So we come to this table that isn't a table, it isn't a Presbyterian table, it is a table for all, because God has called all of us. God has invited all of us. And this table is a reminder of the good news. The good news that God has come for you, that God loves you, that God is willing to sacrifice for you. And it is a reminder of just how good that news is and just how much we should be filled with joy and wonder and awe. So as you come forward this day, remember and be filled with awe about what this table represents and the fact that there is a place reserved for you at it. It was so that we might be able to know God and be counted among God's family. Then on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks for it, he broke it, and he handed it to his disciples, and he said to them, "Take ye, this is my body broken for you." And then after supper, in much the same way, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant. The new covenant sealed in my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim my death until I come again." Friends, Christ has prepared a feast of blessing for you and for me and for all. So I invite you to come and receive the gifts of God, for you are the people of God. And when we say all, we mean all. So even if you're gluten-free, we've got you covered up here. Okay? This is the Lord's table, and all are invited. Come and receive God's gift.